Welcome to the third joint meeting in 2023 of members of the Criminal Justice, the Health, Social Care and Sport and the Social Justice and Social Security Committees to consider the progress made in implementing the recommendations of the Scottish Drugs Death Task Force. We have apologies from Gillian Martin. Paul O'Kane will be arriving a little late due to another commitment. Agenda item one is to decide whether to take item three in private, which is to review today's evidence. Are members agreed?
Yes. Agreed.
Thank you very much. Our next item of business is an evidence session on tackling drug death and drug harm. And I'm pleased to welcome our witnesses today. They are Elena Whitton, MSP, Minister for Drugs and Alcohol Policy, Orlando Hedgemar Mason, Head of Drugs Policy Division, Michael Crook, Drug Policy Team Leader, Harm Reduction Team, Scottish Government, and Suzanne Miller, Chief Officer, Glasgow City Health and Social Care Partnership. I refer members to papers 1 and 2, and I thank the witnesses for their written submissions. And I invite the Minister to make some brief opening remarks of no more than 3 minutes, please, Minister.
Thank you very much, Convener, and thanks to all three committees for coming together to focus on this issue, which cuts across all of your portfolios. We are now at the midpoint of the national mission, and we have seen significant progress in many areas. There has been a huge increase in naloxone distribution, improvement in our surveillance and early warning systems, progress in the implementation of the medication-assisted treatment standards, and an increase in residential rehabilitation referrals and capacity. And as a government, we have taken a truly whole systems approach to tackling drugs deaths and the underlying drivers. And our response to the Drugs Deaths Task Force set out bold actions, including in mental health and oral health, community pharmacies, and developing a concessionary travel pilot. We recently published our second annual report, and I hope that members have had a chance to read to see the depth of and the range of work which is being delivered. This progress is not just due to our increased investment. It is very much due to a huge concerted effort by people and organisations right across the country. And my respect and thanks goes out to them. This really, truly is a national mission. 2022 saw the first annual reduction in drugs deaths since 2017. And whilst I do welcome this record fall, I also want to reaffirm my commitment to continue the national mission and recognise that we still have a lot of work to do. I will never underestimate the scale of the challenge that we continue to face, including responding to new threats such as synthetic opioids and an ever-increasing stimulant use. We will continue to implement evidence-based policies to reduce deaths and to improve the lives of people affected by substance use, and we are continuing with our commitment to put people with lived and living experience at the heart of everything that we do. And we recently had a debate in the Chamber focused on drug law reform. That debate highlighted the limitations and the barriers that we still face. A key facet of drug law reform is the ability for Scotland to be able to implement actions which we know will save lives. One example is safer drug consumption facilities, and I again welcome the position from the Lord Advocate and the confirmation from the UK Government that they will not seek to block or prevent the proposals in Glasgow. Safer drug consumption facilities are important, but they are only one small part of a much wider picture when it comes to supporting people wherever they are. And I look forward to the opportunity today to provide wider updates through this evidence session. Thanks, Convener.
Thank you very much, Minister. And we are going to move straight to questions. And the first question is from Audrey Nicol.
Thanks very much, Convener. And thank you, Minister, for that update. Can I just say at the last meeting, which unfortunately you were unable to attend, I thought it was a very positive meeting. Obviously, with the timing of the meeting, the focus was very much on the recent announcements around the Safe Consumption Room Facility Pilot in Glasgow. And I think we were very welcoming of that, as were our panel members. As an Aberdeen MSP, I'm interested in the proposals to extend the provisions that are being developed in Glasgow to that of drug checking facilities. And I just wondered if you could perhaps provide some details on perhaps extended timescales or expected timescales in and around that, and what exactly a drug checking facility would look like.
Thank you very much for your question and also for the recognition at the beginning just about the work that this cross-committee does. And I think cross-committees really are invaluable. And I think that we should be doing more of them where we can do. With regards to drug checking, there was a two-year study that happened that was funded by the Drugs Desk Task Force to actually look at what does Scotland's drug checking facilities look like and what do we need. And one of the things that it told us was that we need them to be situated with some of our bigger cities, and obviously Aberdeen City is one of such areas. But it also told us that on top of those three areas, so you know we have Dundee, Glasgow and Aberdeen, that we also had a need for a national hub, and that's going hopefully be sited within Dundee's university. And because we recognise that whilst we need to have those drug checking facilities within communities within easy access of individuals, we also need to have that national facility that will allow robust checking of the results found at a local level, but also that perhaps at one point in time we'll be able to move to the model that is in Wales with the Wedonos service, where people are actually able to post in drugs for them to be checked on that basis. And I think when it comes to timescales at this point in time, and we've had some clarification from the Home Office with regards to some of the information that will need to be supplied and submitted by the local areas when they submit their applications. And one of the issues that we're trying to work through just moment is round about the legalities surrounding the transportation of those substances. So once we can get into a position where that's nailed down, I think that the applications are going to go in as quickly as we need them to go into.
And I'm sure that the Minister will be planning to keep the committee or the group updated on that. So it's good to hear that that work is underway. I wonder if just in the short time that we have each for questions, if I could maybe just turn to the issue of, and it's just gone straight out of my head, yes, evaluation. So at the previous meeting, there were some sort of, there was a sort of range of views in and around evaluation, when that should perhaps begin, or at least when, obviously the evaluation will continue now that things are underway in terms of the Glasgow service. However, there was some commentary that in the meantime, work can be taken forward in terms of other locations, other facilities, and there was a range of views on what that might look like. So I'm just interested in your own views on whether or not we should undertake the evaluation should be undertaken, and then look at lessons learned, and then make decisions around how we move that work forward.
Okay, I'm gathering that you're talking about safer consumption facilities. Yeah. So I think that we need to have a robust evaluation process that needs to be flexible and agile. But at the same time, I don't believe that that should stop us from exploring the possibilities of there being other pilots that could be put forward whilst the initial Glasgow pilot is being undertaken. And I think that it's in information that I submitted to the committee. We have had conversations with the Crown Office around about what they would be willing to consider. And I think it's clear that the Lord Advocate would consider a robust application from a local area that actually followed along the parameters of what the initial Glasgow one did. So if we think about an application, we need to be precise and detailed and specific. It would need to be underpinned by evidence from that local area and also supported by those who would be responsible for policing such a facility, such as Police Scotland. So any local area that would seek to put an application in for a pilot to be considered would need to be, making sure that they're satisfying the Lord Advocate of everything that Glasgow did. And I know that there's conversations already being undertaken in the City of Edinburgh about whether they would seek to have such a pilot also in the offing, and officials within Scottish Government are supporting that area to actually explore what that could look like. But we don't need to wait for the full evaluation of the first Glasgow pilot before perhaps other considerations could be put forward from other areas.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Rose McCall. Thank you. Good afternoon, Minister. I'm going to ask a couple of questions on stigma, if I may, and my particular raison d'etre, which is being trauma aware. That's always something that gets me out of bed in the morning. So can the Minister provide an update on the work that's been undertaken with part of the Stigma Action Plan? And I'll just roll the two questions into one, which will cut for time. And can the Minister outline the engagement that has taken place with the third sector to assess its experience of attitudes and whether this has indicated any improvement in these attitudes over time? Thank you.
Yeah, thanks very much for that question. And like yourself, being trauma-informed and making sure we have services that are also trauma-responsive is something that I'm very passionate about. We need a full systems and cultural change if we're truly going to tackle stigma. And part of the government's response to the Drugs Death Task Force report was that we were going to we've launched a Tackling Stigma Action Plan. But whilst we're in the process of rolling that out, we really need to co-design what that looks like. So we're making sure that we work with our third sector partners, our partners in local government and the health and social care partnerships, but also with those people who are experiencing the services. So for them to be supported by and large by the third sector is really important. And I think it's going to take a little bit of time for us to co-design what that stigma action plan is going to look like, because co-design is not simple and it's not easy. And for it to be done really effectively, we need to take that little bit of time to make sure that we can really hear from the voice of lived and living experience. Because if we think about our processes just now, I think sometimes, and you probably heard this from witnesses last week, sometimes we can design stigma into our services by accident. And I think that we need to make sure that we hear from what people that are living through substance use are telling us. And we need to make sure as well that we think about some of those groups who are often not thought of when it comes to the designing of services. So I'm thinking about people from Black and minority ethnic groups who face substance use issues just the same as everybody else. And I'm thinking about services that we need to make sure that are there for women and the specific needs of women, because all too often, when it comes to stigma, it can actually drive people away from the services. So I'm really keen that we hear from all of those voices, and the voices that we talk about as being unheard, but a lot of the time they're actually talking very loudly and we're just not listening to them. So I think that co-design process for me is really vital in terms of getting this right, and that's going to take a wee bit of time.
Okay, can I just possibly come back, just because thank you very much, and that's a very, very full answer. My only concern when anyone ever says we've got to take time, it then becomes never ending, and it can't be never ending when it comes to trauma. Would you be willing to give an indication of how long you would anticipate in some way? I'm not trying to hold anyone to it, but just I don't like the idea of it being a never ending process.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm anticipating that by the time we go into the spring, we're going to have a lot more information round about what that stigma action plan is going to be. We're co-designing a voluntary accreditation scheme that people that are working in services can actually sign up to. So that means that they themselves as a practitioner, but also that their service actually will adhere to looking at how they can reduce stigma and actually drive it down. So that's really important. And also we're supporting organisations to launch campaigns like the See Beyond, See the Lives campaign, which is run with a few partner organisations to actually get the stories behind the people. And we've heard really powerfully from colleagues, MSP colleagues, about the stigma that they faced as families. So there's a lot going on in the background, but I will keep the committee and the rest of the chamber up to date on that.
Thank you, Minister. Thanks. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Sue Weber.
Thank you, Convener. Yes, Minister, you mentioned about the evaluation methodology, and I'm glad that the Chief Officer from Glasgow Health and Social Care Partnership is here today. You spoke about it being robust, flexible and agile, and I suppose I'm looking for some reassurance that it might also be very independent.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's a really good question to ask, because I think that we need to have challenge, we need to have scrutiny, we need to have independent eyes on some of these things. I would probably pass to Suzanne for her to help us with understanding what the evaluation process from a Glasgow perspective on it is, because obviously from a government perspective that will look slightly different. And my scrutiny would be on the evaluation that Glasgow would be taking forward. So happy to hand over to Suzanne for that. Thanks.
Thank you. And thanks, Convener. The process in terms of evaluation at this point in time has been led by the Director of Public Health within Greater Glasgow and Clyde Health Board, Dr. Amelia Crichton. But we are working with an expert academic group, and what we're looking for is there's two universities who are working together to look at a bid in relation to the evaluation and that being entirely independent. That's how we operated the Enhanced Drug Treatment Service, so we have got experience of that independent evaluation. So we have a lot of interest, as you can imagine, in the evaluation of the Safer Drug Consumption Facility. So I'm confident that we will be successful, that the universities will be successful in terms of their bids, and we'll work with them in terms of that evaluation. Public Health Scotland are already funded to do some baseline study work prior to the service opening, so that at the point where the service operates, that evaluation can start almost immediately. That was a learning from the Enhanced Drug Treatment Service evaluation, that we had to spend quite a bit of time on baseline once the service was open. So that's something that we can do in preparation. Public Health Scotland are doing that on our behalf, so that element's independent as well.
Thank you, Suzanne. I suppose it's not hidden that our party has a different, perhaps, perspective on the Safer Drug Consumption Facilities than others, and we are very much looking forward to seeing the evidence before we take a position on consumption facilities being set up more widely across the city. But I am aware that the council in Edinburgh is considering these things, and I'm also very aware that the service in Glasgow has been funded by the Scottish Government. The IGB in Edinburgh is in critical financial strife at the moment, and I would have grave concerns if their consumption facility was to be funded from their existing budget, so I'm looking for a bit of assurance on that. But also, the Minister and I have shared some correspondence more verbally recently around the priorities that I think some of the IGBs and the EADPs need to be having around the MAT standards, and specifically with that one case of the constituent from my area who was in prison, in Edinburgh prison, and was on Buvidol, and then when presented at the South West office within Edinburgh was told they couldn't have that and would have to come back within 2 weeks and potentially have to result to going back onto methadone. There is a mix match here in terms of the harm reduction versus the real embedding and investment that's needed at the local level to really help our individuals. And I'm looking, I don't want a cart before a horse here. I want the services to help people recover there before those that prevent the harm.
On your first point with regards to resourcing, the resourcing of any other project that would come forward in terms of safer consumption would be an ongoing process that would happen between my officials and officials within Edinburgh. So that's not something that I can foresee, but I do take your point in terms of just the pressness perhaps of the budgets that are within.
A safer drug consumption facility being funded at the expense of other critical services in Edinburgh, because we can't afford to cut any of those. That's my main point, Minister. Yeah.
And I absolutely take your point on that. With regards to the case that was brought to both of our attentions on social media, that was something that straight away I asked officials to start looking into, because it told a story of an individual's journey that does not reflect what an individual's journey should be from that setting. So if we zoom out from that one person and just think about the journey as it should happen, when somebody has a transition from any setting, whether that's a hospital setting, a prison setting, there should be a cohesive plan in place that means that somebody doesn't see their medication or anything else fall between the cracks, whether that's presenting as homelessness, etc. So that individual should have had a seamless change from the prison facility into the community setting. So I'm still waiting to see what perhaps could have been some of the difficulties in that situation. And what we do know is that within Glasgow, they've got a named person standard operating, Edinburgh, they have a named person standard operation procedure in place, which means that the specific patient has the ability for the medication to follow, because you need a Home Office licence to store that Buvidol medication. Mm-hmm. So at the point of transfer, the person should be able to have a long-acting injectable buprenorphine be set up for the next time that they're due to have that. So that there has to have been a breakdown in communication somewhere. So there has to be learning from this, because this cannot be something that happens regularly across the country. And I think that it also harks back to, if we think about the SHORE standards in terms of when somebody makes that transition from a prison setting back into the community setting, their healthcare should follow their support needs in terms of housing, etc., should also follow. Their support needs in terms of access to welfare benefits should also follow. So I'm happy to keep the member informed.
I would be grateful.
Also keep the committee informed just about what could be learned from this once I get a fuller picture back.
That's very helpful. And, of course, then we can make sure that it's no other person falls through to the system like that.
Absolutely.
Thank you very much, Minister.
Might I add something? Sorry. Just to the point you were making earlier about evaluation. So obviously we would all want any evaluation of the consumption facility in Glasgow to be so robust that it doesn't matter whether you're sceptical or passionate about it, to be able to recognise its findings. And just to let the committee know that at official level we've been speaking to the Home Office as well, and I've made an offer to the Home Office that their questions they might have about evaluation make the introduction to Glasgow, so that any questions they will have, and there's a lot of interest across the UK, including in the Home Office, about the outcome of the pilot, are reflected in the evaluation, and that they get from it what they would like to see as well.
That's very helpful. Thank you.
Colette Stevenson.
Thanks very much, Convener. And I just wanted to touch upon one thing in relation to the safe consumption rooms and the pilot scheme, and then I'm going to move on to the national specification. So it says in one of the recommendations from the Drug Task Force, currently many drug services do not operate in evenings or at weekends. We must provide emergency care 24/7 with out-of-hours referral points for people to access if needed. But I note from the pilot scheme that it's only available from 9 a.m. to 9 p.m. Is this something that is actually getting looked at, or will that come out in the evaluation that you touched upon?
Yeah, I'll first answer part of that, and then I'll see if Suzanne also wants to come in. I think if we think about the running costs of such a facility, staffing it from that time frame, is reflective in, I guess, the tariff that we know that it's going to cost us. But I do recognise that people will use drugs at all times of the day, so that there is a need as well to look at how we can assess as the pilot develops what the real-time information is telling us about individuals' habits and how individuals are actually engaging with that service. But it's something that I've certainly thought about, and I'm sure it's something that Glasgow thought about as well.
Yeah, thanks. So just to add to that, so it's 9 till 9, 7 days a week, 365 days a year. And in terms of one of the pieces of work specifically we're doing just now is its connection into those wider services. So going back to the earlier question, we very much see the Safer Drug Consumption Facility as part of the wider offer in Glasgow City. And there are a number of integrated addiction services. A couple of them are the crisis outreach, that are specific to your question, are the crisis outreach team and our mental health assessment units, which operate through 24/7, also have an alcohol and drugs component to them. So what we're working on just now is what the pathways would be for people using those existing services. But the Minister quite rightly says to run 24/7, 7 days a week, 365 days a year wasn't something. It's not how the other safer drug consumption facilities across the globe operate either. So we have looked at other places in terms of the evidence base. But your question's entirely correct about making sure the pathways into the those other services that we have in place needs to be really clear for people, and that'll be something that we will work on.
Okay, that's pretty reassuring, especially for people with addictions being signposted out with those hours as well. But touching upon the national specifications as well, the committee have obviously heard previously that some of the difficulties actually faced by people accessing services. So I wonder if the Minister can provide an update on what is happening with the national specification and provide any details on what the national specification will include. Thank you.
Thanks very much for that question on the national specification. It is something that is clearly there from the Drugs Death Task Force and their report. And I think that speaks to the variation of services that we do see throughout the country, and perhaps the need to roll some things into a national specification. But whilst there is work ongoing with stakeholders through various working groups already in place to consider what type of more formal service specification would benefit people relying on services, we're at this moment making sure that we are pushing with the rollout of the medication-assisted treatment standards, which is one part of a national specification of treatment. And if we're also thinking about residential rehabilitation, and we're working towards a national commissioning protocol for that as well, so that we can actually make sure that local areas are able to effectively get people on their journey into residential rehabilitation and then back into the community, because that's been proven to be quite difficult for local areas to do that. And I think if we actually look at Scotland XL, which those of us that have ever been in local authority know as the kind of I see lots of wry smiles there, is that body that does help with that kind of procurement work. So we're now at the point where we will be looking to go out to the tendering process, where organisations that are providing residential rehabilitation facilities would actually be able to get themselves onto a national framework. And that will provide a directory for local areas, but also a directory for individuals. Because right now, as it stands, people don't know what residential rehabilitation is out there for them. They don't know what each of the types of services might provide for them. And by actually bringing that into a kind of a national oversight of it, it means that hopefully that journey and that access to that, those facilities will be easier for individuals. And I think when we think about the kind of governance structures around about this as well, a national specification, when we get to that point of understanding what the working groups are telling us, will also help to have a read across both spheres of government and all of the partners and their actual individual responsibilities, and how we can actually quantify what that should look like in practice, and so that there's clear lines of accountability. Because I obviously have accountability on a national level, but also need to look to local partners in terms of their accountability. And I think national specification will help us to do that.
Okay. No, that's very helpful. Thank you very much.
Do you have anything to add onto that?
The only thing I was going to add was about the service directory, which we'll be launching shortly, which is just a website where people can find out what residential rehab services are available to them.
Okay, thank you very much. Russell Finlay.
Thank you, Convener. I think we've got about 5 minutes, so I've got three or four questions. I'll try my best to rattle through them. Now, suspected drugs deaths are up again in the first 6 months of the year, 7%, which equates to, I think, 600 lost lives. And it's absolutely correct that we're treating this as a public health approach. But there remains a serious problem with organised crime groups preying on vulnerable people. I've raised concerns about organised crime influencing mainstream sections of the society, including football and boxing, which I find obscene and outrageous. So what I suppose I'm seeking from the government is some kind of explanation or assurance that the police are continuing to have the resources they need to tackle these parasites.
Yeah, I mean, I think all of us can recognise across, this room at the moment, that serious and organised crime is very harmful to our communities and is insidious. It's in all different levels that sometimes people don't think that serious and organised crime is. Now, whilst it would be for the Cabinet Secretary for Justice to actually comment on the funding situation of the police, I think in a cross-government look at it, I would be seeking to make sure that police and their response to the areas that I'm responsible for are resourced for that. I think we need to recognise that when we do have situations where we can interrupt county lines activity, where we can take vast quantities of drugs off our street by actually interrupting those gangs, and also where those our police in Scotland can work with the UK serious and organised crime professionals, and indeed across the whole of Europe and beyond, where those supplies sometimes are interrupted, as the Minister responsible for drugs and alcohol policy, I need to be also aware about where the harms transfer at that point. So in my experience, where we do have a huge quantity of substances sometimes taken off of the streets, we then end up with harm diverted to a different area. So I think there's a dual aspect to that. So I will absolutely support the Cabinet Secretary for Justice and colleagues in terms of making sure the police are resourced, but also think about the unintended consequences.
A quick question about drug consumption rooms, a pilot in Glasgow. Dr. Sakit Priyadarshi told the BBC that crack cocaine or any other substances that are smoked or inhaled were removed from the original plan because of the smoking ban. Now, this is, as far as I can see, very little pickup. And I suppose my question is that being reviewed? Is it likely to be included, substances of that nature? And if so, does it then raise potential questions around staff safety?
Yeah, it's a very interesting question, Mr. Finlay, and I think there's a few parts to that. So the smoking ban does play a part in terms of smoking indoors. We know that. But also the Misuse of Drugs Act actually has a part within it that prevents people from supporting the consumption of smokable substances. There we go. Thank you. Smokable substances. And I think that shows, you know, how outdated that might be, because that was thinking around about opium. So we know that there's going to be a challenge in terms of how that facility could operate, because we, you know, there are more and more people that are using crack cocaine that are going to be freebasing that, and it's not going to be able to be used within the facility as it stands. But we also know that there's a lot of people who are injecting cocaine. So people who are injecting cocaine would be able to do that within the facility. But I'm going to pass to Suzanne really quickly just to bring her in if she's got anything to add to that. That's okay.
Yes, and being careful, what we say publicly, we had really detailed legal advice. Glasgow City had really detailed legal advice in relation to this, and that precisely, as the Minister said, that made it far too complex to put something in front of the Lord Advocate with Scottish Government support that would have been likely to get the outcome that we did. So, and also our population that we are most concerned about are far more likely to inject cocaine.
Very quick question on naloxone. Scottish Fire and Rescue Service have secured an agreement with the Fire Brigade Union to, in principle, all firefighters to carry this. There's been some resistance. Some firefighters are doing so voluntarily. That proposal is with Scottish Government. I just wonder what's happening with that.
Yeah, again, if we think about the broadening the firefighters' role, there's some complexities round about how that would operate in practice. And I think that we will consider their proposal back to us in terms of them carrying it. I'm grateful for those firefighters that just now are carrying it on a voluntary basis. And like the police force before that, there was a lot of things to work through to get the confidence for those frontline workers to carry it. I think the nasal spray of naloxone has made that much easier for them to do. Yep.
Doing it for quite some time. Fire Brigade have not yet reached an agreement. Do you know, do you have any sense of when this might happen, when the likelihood of an agreement might be reached or otherwise?
I don't know if officials do. I don't have any insight into that at the moment, but Michael might do.
Thank you. No, it's not something that we have an information on at the moment, but we have been working with the Fire and Rescue Service for a while, and we've provided them with funding around naloxone, carriage of naloxone, but we can certainly check back on that and come back to the committee with further information.
Thank you. I've got a very final question in relation to drug checking services. Audrey Nicholls already talked about these, and in a recent debate you correctly said that there's no such thing as a safe consumption room. It's safer consumption rooms. Some of these substances are inherently dangerous and there's no getting away from that. So what I don't understand, and it's maybe just naivety on my part, is what would the purpose of a drugs testing or checking facility or service be? If you're checking for the purity, are you checking for the identity of the substance? And then what happens if you're telling people that is the substance you believe it to be? Is that essentially giving a kind of green light to take it when in itself it could pose a danger to them? Or if you give a red light? Because it just seems all very confusing, a bit of a legal minefield. And I just wonder what work's been done to establish what the actual purpose of these would be.
Yeah, I'm very clear in my mind what a purpose for drug checking would be, and that's actually about furnishing individuals with information. I think that all of us would recognise that information is power in every single aspect of our lives. So if you're somebody
But if you're taking a substance and you believe you've bought the substance in question and you get it tested and they say, yes, that is indeed the substance, the authorities are therefore potentially directing people to take something that could harm them.
I think we're giving people the information about what the substance contains, because I think what we're seeing just now is an increasing toxic supply that's out there, and what an individual might think is a tislam, as a street benzo, actually might come back to show that it's containing some synthetic opioids. I do take your point about whether it actually contains the substance that that individual thought it would, but that in itself allows them to still make a decision about whether they continue to use it and how they use it.
That might be beneficial to people.
If we have time at the end, we'll come back to you for a second.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Alex Cole-Hammond.
Well, thank you very much, Convener, and can I thank you for allowing me to join your committee's deliberations today. Minister, you know that I am supportive of the government's approach to harmful substance use and deaths caused by the same. I'm actually going to ask a question about something, a topic we've not discussed before between us, and that is something you touched on briefly in your remarks and briefly in an answer to Russell Finlay there, and that is synthetic opioids. I have here in front of me a graph from the United States that says in 2012, just over 2,500 people died from the substance known as fentanyl, or predominantly fentanyl. But last year, that had jumped to 73,500. I mean, there's an epidemic of opioid misuse in synthetic opioid misuse in the States, which has not yet been realised on our shores. But that time may be changing. I understand, I mean, the metrics speak for themselves, but since the Taliban took control of Afghanistan in April 22, they instituted a national ban on the growth in sale of the opium poppy, and as a result opium export from Afghanistan has dropped right off, and stakeholders are concerned there may only be 18 months left in the illicit global heroin supply, which means that the vacuum that creates may well then be filled by synthetic opioids like fentanyl predominantly, but also Captagon coming out of countries like Syria. I just wonder, first and foremost, what work is your government preparing in terms of the surveillance as to what people are taking so that we can get early warning of this if it hits our shores? Because the death rates from fentanyl are far, far worse than heroin.
Absolutely. I recognise every single thing that Alex Cole-Hamilton has just outlined there. And I think that we invested in our rapid action drug alert system because we needed to know what was actually happening in real terms on the ground. So if we think about the most recent radar report, it actually does start to talk about the fact that we are seeing these synthetic stronger opioids actually make their presence felt within certainly the UK, but also within Scotland. So that gives me huge cause for concern. Just this week, I was on a call with some of our international experts in Canada and from the States to actually talk to them about what would they do differently now if they actually were able to do that again. What are we doing in Scotland that's actually going to help us, and what could we be doing in Scotland that might actually help us to address what potentially could be coming down the line? And if I think back to Mr. Finlay's question around about serious and organised crime, it's far easier to transport the substances and to actually get hold of the substances for synthetics than it is to cultivate a crop that's dependent on so many other factors, never mind the geopolitical factors. So I am really worried about potentially what we're seeing, and that's why I think we need to make sure that we have the ability for drug checking and testing to be done, because people need to know what's in the substances. But we also need to know ourselves what's happening in terms of when we have hospital admissions. So we've got the pilot assist project that's actually ongoing within the Queen Elizabeth Hospital in Glasgow that actually does routine testing of individuals when they come in to find out what substances are at play. So that information and that surveillance will help us, but we need to make sure that we look to speak to those global leaders that are already dealing with this issue. So just shortly, I will be convening a roundtable with other international experts round about that. And the hope is that once that work progresses, that can be opened up to other parliamentarians to be part of, so that as a whole parliament, we can make sure that we're understanding just what the threat that's coming down the line and how quickly that could possibly take hold.
And can I ask, in terms of crisis response and overdose mitigation, are we confident that, you know, the processes and interventions that we have at our disposal, whether that's naloxone or other interventions, are applicable to the synthetic opioids coming in? Are we learning from our North American colleagues as to what interventions prove efficacious in those countries? And are we ready to adopt them fast? Because this is something that could happen very fast. Are you confident that we're in a good place on that?
I think our national naloxone programme rollout that's actually been ongoing for over a decade is actually standing in good stead already in terms of that. We do know that naloxone does work on the synthetics. It might be that you need to have multiple doses, but you certainly will have to actually phone the emergency services at the same time and continue to see whether that person needs another dose of naloxone. And that's something that we're clearly seeing from international evidence that says it will still work, but you need to make sure that you've got quantities to be able to react to that. When it comes to the drug checking, I think that, you know, we need that to roll out as low thresholds as it can do, but we will need to work through what pilots are going to look like, what they're going to tell us and how they evaluate, and we have to operate within the Misuse of Drugs Act at the same time. I am meeting in 2 weeks, a week and a half, with all four nations in terms of those that were the ministers that are responsible for drug policy. And I think that the synthetics are going to be one of the things that are foremost on our conversation, because it's recognised across the whole of the UK that this is an incoming issue. And as for other things that we know that could help, you know, safer consumption facilities are one of those things where you'll have professionals and supportive and people on standby to make sure that they can respond to any crisis. And just this week we've had the rollout of safe supplies held of naloxone within community pharmacy. And I think we all recognise community pharmacies are at the heart of our community, and they're really well placed to deliver that life-saving treatment. So having that available everywhere is a real boon.
Fantastic. And final question, if I may, convene.
Sorry, we need to move on, Ms. Cole. Okay. I will come back to you at the end if we've got time. I'll move to Katie Clark.
Thank you. Minister, you've made clear that you've been in discussion with the Crown Office, and the Lord Advocate has stated that it would not be in the public interest to prosecute users of drug consumption rooms for simple possession offences, and that she would be prepared to draft a prosecution policy along those lines. Have you engaged with the Lord Advocate on that point, and what legal protections will be in place for staff at drug consumption facilities?
What we do know is that Police Scotland themselves have actually created an operation procedure that that will dictate how they actually police that, you know, any such facility. And that is something that is for Police Scotland to communicate. I think when we think about the staff, absolutely you're 100% right, Katie Clark, to bring up how they would feel protected mm-hmm. within such a facility. Mm-hmm. And I guess it's for Suzanne to reassure us as to then, you know, the advice that Glasgow has taken on that. Because as a minister, I'm, you know, keen that I believe that the individuals that are going to be supporting our, some of our most vulnerable citizens, that they are protected themselves. So I'll hand over to Suzanne for that.
Thank you. So, yeah, that, clearly that is of significant consideration and concern for ourselves, but and has been for some time, just understanding the legal parameters which we would need to operate within. And it's our understanding at this point, but we are refreshing that advice, that if we have the standard operating procedures in place, and we have a clear training and support plan for our staff, and we have systems through clinical and care governance that assure us that our staff are following those standard operating procedures, then that is the protection for the staff, that they operate within those expectations, which are, have to be clearly set out in formal standard operating procedures, mm-hmm. which are part of the induction and ongoing training. So that's the advice that we had at the stage that was under consideration by the Lord Advocate, but clearly before we would open any mm-hmm. service, we're refreshing and reassuring mm-hmm. ourselves. That advice remains current.
So that's an ongoing matter that you've got under active consideration. My next question is to the Minister. And it's estimated that there's been a cut of around £19 million to the funding of Scotland's drug and alcohol partnerships. And given the role that those partnerships play in trying to address the drugs deaths public health emergency, clearly funding is quite an essential issue. I am not going to ask the Minister to make an undertaking in terms of what will be in the budget, but what I am going to ask that she does is make a commitment that she will make the case in the strongest terms as to why those cuts need to be reversed and there needs to be further funding devoted to those partnerships. Is that something that she would feel able to commit to?
I will always make robust representations when it comes to the portfolio and the individuals that my portfolio policy seeks to support right across the country. I think what I need to refute at this point is that there is any notion of any reduction in budgets.
In the budget, in the forthcoming budget.
Well,
historically,
in the past budget as well. So if we think about what happened last year in terms of funding going to the ADPs, there was the money that was made available to ADPs never changed. What we did ask ADPs to do, and which is fiscally prudent to ask any organisation to do when you're publicly funding it, is to make sure that any unspent reserves that they were carrying were actually used in the first instance, and then that they sought to draw down after that. Now, there was provision made for any non-recurring spend that ADPs had perhaps earmarked against projects that they were doing, that they needed that funding for, but the full envelope of the money was there. And if we think about the total drugs and alcohol budget, it's steadily increased over the last few years. So in 2021-22, it was 140.7 million. 22-23, it was 141.9, and again for 23-24, that is projected to be 155.5 million. So I will always seek to make those representations in the most strongest of terms. I think what I could also seek to reassure the full committee is that we have baselined, as of next year coming, approximately two-thirds of ADP funding will be baselined. And that means that that funding is there and that funding is committed and it's going to be recurring, which hopefully will allow ADPs to start to feel more comfortable in their long-term spending commitments and their planning. But absolutely give you my guarantee that I will make robust representations for the budget.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Paul O'Quinn. Oh, sorry. Paul Sweeney.
It's easy to mix us up. It's the glasses, I think. Thank you, convener. I went along to the Community Council consultation event on the 28th of September in the Calton. It's fair to say it was fairly confrontational. What lessons have been learned from that exercise?
Do you want to direct that to Suzanne?
Thanks for the question. We're used to robust community consultation in terms of the services that we deliver in Glasgow City Health and Social Care Partnership. And we're committed to that ongoing honest conversation with the local communities and beyond. Since then, we have the Community Council. We've been talking to the Community Council about how we keep that discussion going. We've also had a discussion with three of the local housing associations. We've met with the local business developer, and we had previously met with the locally elected members from Glasgow City Council. And we've got an engagement plan that takes us all the way through to the turn of the year in terms of that local engagement and taking us slightly beyond the immediate. In terms of what would be learned, those conversations are difficult conversations. I would expect them to be. They're honest conversations. It's my observation, because I did speak to the Community Council after the chair. It's my observation that once we had set out our stall, that people did actually go away and think about what we had said to them. And again, part of that experience is we'll repeat that and go back to them, because people do need a lot of time to absorb that information. We are steeped in it. Their anxieties are entirely understandable and reasonable, and we will need to spend quite a bit of time in that dialogue with them, and we're absolutely committed to it. But robust consultation is something that we would expect, not only in this area of work, but across our work.
Do you anticipate using examples from other countries or lived experience from other countries in our jurisdictions who have experienced the rollout of these facilities in your communication plan with the local community?
Yes, I mean, so, and I should have mentioned, I mean, another critical element of the consultation engagement is our own, is the people that we work with lived and living experience, and that is going well. Also with families, so we've got a number of family groups affected by addictions, as you would know, in Glasgow City, and we've got really strong working relationships with them. We've had some offers from them to be part of the consultation engagement, so that the story that's told is a Glasgow story, and that's one that resonates. But we've previously had contact, particularly with Bergen in Canada, who've got some really powerful stories from lived and living experience. But our first port of call would be our own people, if that's the right way to put it.
Sure, that's really helpful. One of the major concerns raised in the meeting was the role of the police. There was a lot of anger that the police hadn't been present And I think actually that's a fair point because they haven't really been present at all in this public discussion beyond sort of platitudes. So is there appetite from Police Scotland to be more engaged in this, particularly around the concerns about dealing and the how dealing will manifest itself within the local community as a result of this facility?
Yeah, that was one of the specific actions we picked up from the Community Council meeting. So we have raised that with Police Scotland. We have a new divisional commander who is absolutely committed to the engagement plan that we've shared with him. And he has committed that our Police Scotland colleagues will be involved in that. So, sorry, I should have mentioned that as a lessons learned. You're absolutely right.
That's very helpful. Just also wanted to ask, I went to visit the H17 facility in Copenhagen on the 12th of October, and one of the key points that was raised in discussion with them was the strength of the co-location of services, but also they had some concerns about the direct co-location of the enhanced drug treatment service with the OPC. Do you potentially see that as a potential area for concern?
So it was actually one of the recommendations of the Taking Away the Chaos report back in 2015-16, which was the genesis for the work that we did in relation to both the enhanced drug treatment service and the start of our work on a safer drug consumption facility. And actually the recommendation from that report was that they were co-located. We're cognizant of the fact that the co-location in particular assists the clinical leadership to make sure that we've got a really good support system for staff who are involved in providing those services. But very cognizant of the fact, for example, that they'll need to be very discreet services in terms of their access because they're very different. It's self-referral. It's really low threshold access to the safer drug consumption facility. And it's quite different. Sorry, I'm doing that because they're going to have very different entrances and different ways to get in. That's why I'm using my hands to explain that. So we're cognizant of the fact that they have to be separate in terms of the understanding of people using them. But from our perspective, in relation to that sort of clinical oversight, there are real overlaps, and it was one of the recommendations that they were co-located.
It's just also just about the ability to adjust in real time during the pilot as well. One of the lessons from Copenhagen was 24-hour coverage. The centre, there's two centres within about 200 metres of each other. They operate 23 hours a day. They close for an hour for cleaning. Are you concerned that there might be an issue with the opening hours and there's an opportunity to potentially extend that quite quickly within the pilot if it's deemed obvious that that's a need?
So I think it relates back to the question I think we got on evaluation. What we're looking to do is to be agile but also cognisant of the fact that we're working. We need to be take the Lord Advocate's view and the framework within which we're operating really seriously. So we need to make sure that we don't adapt to anything that actually cuts across that. So the evaluation will be reporting on an ongoing basis, and we will be able to make operational changes, again, as we did in the Enhanced Drug Treatment Service. But we need to be absolutely crystal clear that we continue to adhere to the expectations that the Lord Advocate has given us.
Thanks.
Thanks. Just to that, I think that that clearly demonstrates to me why, as a UK as a whole, if we actually saw a move towards looking at how we could have an array of different types of safer consumption facilities available or indeed give us the ability with devolved powers to do that, because then that would allow us to be more flexible and more agile in terms of responding at the same time, and also having perhaps more third sector partners involved in terms of providing and delivering those services. So I think whilst we know that it's going to save lives when we do get this pilot up and running, I think that demonstrates again some of the constraints that we're operating under.
Okay, thanks.
And this time, Paul Keane.
I'm very grateful, Convener, and apologies to you and colleagues for having to come to committee late. I'm interested in MAT standards, and I know there's been perhaps a touch on this in other questions, but the recent benchmarking report from Public Health Scotland, I think, found patchy progress, it's fair to say, and challenges that I think were identified around a bit of a postcode lottery of what's happening in different parts of the country. So I wonder if, firstly, the Minister might be able to speak to progress on the MAT standards and why she thinks that kind of outcome is patchy at the moment.
Yeah, I think if we think back to the first year when the MAT standards were first discussed, and remember that these came from the Drugs Deaths Task Force themselves, that concerted effort working with people with lived and living experience and partners to create what those 10 standards should look like. You're talking about an entire systems and culture change of services to try and deliver at pace on the ground. And I think what makes it difficult from the beginning was the fact that ADPs are all set up in different ways. Health and social care partnerships are set up in different ways. So we started from a really difficult and complex starting position. And whilst I will keep pushing for local areas to deliver on the MAT standards because we need them to, because we know that it's going to save lives, I think that the fact that we managed to get to two-thirds of the areas having delivered 1 to 5 last year was a big step change. I am really conscious of the fact that standards 6 to 10 are where we really start thinking about, you know, the advocacy work, the trauma-informed work, the psychological support, the mental health support, how we actually start to embed the MAT standards within primary care, and those are going to be really tricky. And for me, it's about actually still having those robust conversations with local areas. So some areas have moved into monthly reporting, which is really important, and others where we've seen progress have went back to quarterly reporting. And where I think there's going to be specific tricky situations where we've seen areas where the drugs deaths perhaps did not start to decline, or we're seeing that there's still issues that are perennially raising their head, that means that I need to have a sit-down conversation with the areas and in a very supportive way, as opposed to I'm telling you what I think you should do way, because that's not how we need to work. We need to actually make sure that we take areas with us. And I think there has to be a recognition, despite the progress not being as fast as I want it to be, or any of us did, I think that that, you know, people have pulled out all the stops across the country by and large to try and really push expansion of it. Where we're going to find it tricky as well, just because of the way that healthcare operates, is in our justice sentence. So just last night I had a cross-ministerial meeting with other ministers responsible for what healthcare should look like in the prison setting. And of course, knowing that 76% of people upon admission test positive for illicit substances and have significant substance use issues, MAT standards has to work in justice settings. So I'm going to continue to push on that, so that by the time we get to the end of 2025, all 10 are fully implemented. And by the time we get to the end of this parliament, they're sustained and it's business as usual on how we operate.
I would recognise a lot of what the Minister said in terms of the progress we've made on 1 to 5, and I think the challenges that exist in 6 to 10. Is the sense that 1 to 5 was perhaps slightly more straightforward in terms of trying to work to change culture and change attitude and approach, and that 6 to 10 will be more challenging in terms of actual implementation and delivery? And I noticed just at the end there you mentioned the timescale. So, you know, are you committed to 2025 as a point where all 10 should be implemented?
All 10 should be implemented and operational by then, absolutely. And by the end of the Parliament, they must be sustained, and we must find a way forward that means that beyond this Parliament and this Government, that it's business as usual for MAT standards and what people should be expecting. I think the decision in the way that it was split off after the first year predated me, but having a conversation with officials around about that, it perhaps spoke to what was more easy to measure, so that the first five of them were kind of measures that officials within government and officials within local areas thought that it would be perhaps easier to actually benchmark against. And we can't underestimate the work that the MAT Standards Implementation Support Team that's based within public health are doing at the minute, because they've created entire systems round about data capture that didn't exist beforehand. And there's a massive amount of work in capturing experiential data, which is more difficult to quantify. And I think that's why, if you look at the MAT standards, some areas are provisionally green. And they're provisionally green because it's the experiential data which will be led by people with lived experience as peers that are actually capturing it. And that's the information that tells us, this is what says the service says they're doing, but actually, how am I experiencing that service? And I think setting up that data collection was quite tricky too. So I think we need to recognise the sheer amount of work that's been undertaken there as well.
Thank you. We have an absolute hard stop at 2:05. So I'm going to go to Sue Webber for a very brief supplementary and a very brief response, please, Minister.
It may even be more directed towards Suzanne Miller, because I was curious about the community engagement that you were talking about and the community councils, and you're having to go back to them. What will change ultimately from any community consultation? Are you not going ahead with this irrespective, and therefore is the engagement not a bit disingenuous?
Thanks for the question. No, absolutely not. No, the engagement with the local community and a range of stakeholders is critical to the success, in our opinion, of the Safer Drug Consumption Facility. We did engage, there was engagement up to the point of the proposal previously, but we weren't able to engage with anyone specific because we didn't have a specific location nor agreement from the Lord Advocate. So the engagement plan is very detailed. An answer to Mr Sweeney's question, that we are well aware of the level of anxiety and the questions that require to be answered by us. That's something we work through. It's something that we are very used to doing. We'll take the local community with us. We know that we have to do that in order for this to be successful. So it's our intention to get that. It's not a one-off. And we're very clear with that particular community council, who are the local community council, that we would be back with, in touch with them. But it's ongoing engagement. It wasn't a one-off consultation exercise. It's ongoing engagement. The people that Safer Drug Consumption Facility will support are the citizens of Glasgow, and they are the sons, daughters, brothers, aunts of the people that live in our city, and that's what we will work with local community council on.
I think if I'm able just to add another.
I don't know if we will have time, because Russell Finlay also wants a very brief supplementary, as we have an absolute hard stop at 2:05.
It was just to say that the Lord Advocate won't proceed with a prosecution statement unless she satisfied herself as well about.
Mr. Finlay.
Thanks very much. It was just in response to the issue raised by Paul Sweeney about the criticism of Police Scotland around drugs consumption rooms. I was quite surprised, because my understanding was Police Scotland have engaged with the government and have been quite supportive of the proposal. So I'd be quite keen to hear your view on that.
Yeah, I would just briefly say to that, I would actually ask yourselves as a cross committee to reach out perhaps to Police Scotland and put questions to them as well, maybe take some evidence from them, because I think that will help you to form that bigger picture. Police Scotland has been very supportive in understanding the need for such a facility. The ACC, Richie was really behind this from the beginning. I think Police Scotland have come on a journey in terms of where they can play their role here. And I think that it probably was an oversight that none of them were available at the Community Council meetings. But I don't think either the two of us can speak for Police Scotland, except to say that over the course of the last, since 2016, they have certainly supported the endeavours.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Can I thank the Minister, her officials and Ms Miller for their attendance today. We'll now move into private session, and I'll pause briefly to allow our witnesses to leave.